We just want to give him an official welcome. I feel like he's earned this through some of the content and the following he's built up. So we want to welcome Corey McMullen here to the live from McMullen Appliance. I'm super happy to have him here. 450,000 plus followers. Love the passion, love the enthusiasm. That's why we wanted to get him here. So a lot of us may know you already. I know I stumbled upon your content long before, you know, this was in the works, and really enjoyed just hearing from you, hearing the passion. I think you can probably sell anything. Give us an overview of kind of, you know, introduce yourself, where are you from, introduce your company, and just kind of how you started this journey on TikTok, if you don't mind.
Sure. My name is Corey McMullen. I work at a family-owned business, brick and mortar, single location business in Smiths Falls, Ontario, which is near Ottawa. We sell primarily appliances, but also mattresses and grills. And we've been there for 33 years. And at the start of COVID, I was actually had another career before I came back to the family business. And I came back right before COVID started. And a lot of things changed. And at the start of that, we had a lot of spare time. And one of the things I did was download TikTok, because we were doing a lot of trying to do a lot more social media videos because we had some spare time. And I didn't really know what TikTok was. And then I was really attracted to the powerful little editor to make short form videos. So I started just using it as an editor, putting videos on other channels, and they weren't really working. And then suddenly we found success on TikTok.
Yeah, I know you were telling me another session that you've done traditional, you know, advertising before. You didn't have any experience doing the social media, and yet you've kind of developed this, your own style and your own way of doing things that's worked. I mean, was it difficult starting on a, you know, a brand new platform and running it?
It wasn't, because we were really fortunate really fast, but I could see that it could get discouraging. You know, we were very fortunate. And yes, in my past career, I produced marketing for stores across Canada. So we did a lot of marketing and print media, and compared to print, there's no comparison. Now we don't do any print advertising whatsoever. We're 100% digital. And really that now is 99% TikTok.
Got it. So you mentioned in COVID, like, things got slow. I think that is, you know, pretty much the norm across. You're brick and mortar, so you need the foot traffic, though. But have you seen TikTok pick up your foot traffic? Have people come from any further to come to your store?
It's been beyond anything we ever expected. At first, it was sort of funny. We would get calls from all over the U.S., and it was kind of strange. We realized, oh, this is odd. We've never had a global audience before. But then we started having people come in saying, I want that machine that you just talked about on TikTok. And then we noticed people driving a little further. So typically we serve about 100 kilometers from our store. Well, we started to see people coming in with trailers driving 200 and 300 kilometers. And we've even had customers drive as far as 600 kilometers to get to our store, which is a six and a half hour drive each way.
Are those people leaving with appliances?
Absolutely. We have, I know it might be hard for people don't know the geography, but it's about a 5 or 6 hour drive to Hamilton from our store. We've had one customer come twice with a trailer, buy six machines that he could buy at 5 or 6 other stores along the way, but he drives to our store, buys them, and drives back. Yeah. And we've had that happen time and time again. Just yesterday, we had a gentleman call from Peterborough, 2.5 hours from my store, couldn't find this machine anywhere around him, didn't want to drive to the big city, drove to our store instead to pick it up.
I think that's kind of an example of, you know, TikTok can extend your reach. I mean, you're a regional guy up there. Now you have this global presence, and your region has now expanded.
Yes.
Because of it.
I was worried, how are we going to serve it? And then I realized people are coming to pick up, because we don't have the capability to deliver 200 or 300 or 400 kilometers away. And these things don't ship very well. They're big, heavy, delicate appliances. So it's been really surprising. And the demographic has been surprising. You know, a lot of our clientele are a little older. And they were the first people coming in to say, I saw your video. And we were blown away from the first time customers come in mentioning it.
Yeah, I feel like there's kind of a stigma that the users on TikTok skew very young, yep. Which, you know, we know they're definitely on the platform, right? But I think when we're talking about people that, you know, have disposable income, that are making purchasing decisions, there is every demographic represented on here.
It's absolutely true. And I've told many people it's a myth. When people say, why are you advertising? Why do you use TikTok? That's just for kids. And I'm like, if you try it, you're going to see the demographic that comes through your door.
So in your specific case, I mean, you're dealing with high value items. I'm assuming that success on TikTok, you know, if a video goes viral or you have a string of, you know, good content, good engagement, doesn't always translate directly into, you know, a sale or a purchase of something. But how does just having a following on TikTok help you be successful in general? It could be personally as well too.
Yes. Okay. I would have said the same thing. We definitely didn't expect sales. We never thought of it as an advertising source, but suddenly people were coming in to buy the machines. Now the other part that hurts, I'm selling a lot more machines for other retailers across North America because people are going out, going to other stores, buying the things I talk about, which is fine. They're not all in my market, but then phoning me to apologize or phoning me to make sure that they bought the right model. So I've had many calls from customers sitting in Home Depot parking lots arguing with their spouse on, well, what did Corey say on his TikTok? So even then, new dealers are out there going to these manufacturers and taking on new products because they've seen my videos. And we get a lot of comments and a lot of phone calls from people just thanking us or emails saying, I just bought this machine. It's the best thing ever. I wish I could have bought it from you.
I know one of the videos I stumbled on initially with yours was your kind of breakdown of I think it was liquid fabric softener and why that's not only harmful for your clothes, but for the machines as well. So I think, you know, people get a lot of joy, not only seeing some of the products in your passion, but also learning a lot of things, right? Sometimes we don't know that we're going to be interested in something until somebody presents it in a very fascinating way.
Yeah, there's a lot of people that don't understand, how do you just shoot a piece of junk in your junk bin and get views? And I tell them, don't take it for granted. You might be bored or used to what you're doing, but you're doing it for a reason. You're doing it day to day. So document it and put it out there. And you'd be surprised how many people are interested to learn about new things.
You said you had success early on. When did you feel like you were kind of gaining some traction on TikTok and say like, hey, this might be a positive thing for us? I know your kind of motto is, you know, document everything to give yourself options to make content. But
yep.
When did you think that this could be a thing? And did you kind of do a lot of trial and error to come up with your style that you have now?
Well, one thing, and I didn't mention it in our conversation, was I had a personal TikTok channel right before the business one. And I went on and made one of those videos where you share three or four facts, or I think I stitched a video where someone said, what's a few interesting facts? And I suddenly had 5,000 followers. And I had no idea what that meant. I thought, oh, shoot, that's easy. I need to open an account for the business. And then we were very fortunate there. And where it really changed, we were filming content. I'm kind of showing what we're doing. Oh, here's the weather. Here's our trucks. And then one day we got a refrigerator in and I turned the camera around and filmed myself and narrated it. And that's when I felt like we really shifted gears for the first time. And then shortly after that, we got a lot of media attention, local news outlets and interviews and some newspaper exposure.
Do you feel like not only showing the product itself, but really showing yourself and your personality is a lot more beneficial than just showcasing products?
Sorry. Yep, absolutely. They want to connect with someone. They want to emotionally connect with someone. People aren't coming to buy from McMullen Appliance. They want to come in and buy from the guy that told them the truth or the guy that exposed or did it in a way that isn't this sanitized type of advertising that you get from every other source, you know, and the same message from every retailer, which is the same Sizzler summer savings or the rebate event or whatever it is. We're cutting through all that noise by being so different.
Let's say that, you know, somebody is producing content regularly. They're trying different things. They're not having any traction. What would you kind of recommend as the first couple of things for content production for somebody new to it or someone just, you know, having a little trouble kind of getting some traction?
Well, you're only ever one video away from becoming viral. So always remember that. You don't know which one it's going to be. And really examine your hook. Your hook, regardless of the length of your video, those first 2 seconds of that video are 80% of your entire video. And if you watch all of the metrics when you get into a business account and you have access to more metrics and you can see where people are dropping off and they all look like some sort of ski hill. There's always high engagement at first and then they drop off. And then the better your video, the more of a smooth slope it is. So really hit the ground running. Don't waste your time with intros. You know, my early videos, hey guys, it's Corey from McMullen Appliance. Well, I just wasted 1 or 1.5 seconds of the two. When people scroll to their TikTok video, their thumbs are already cocked and loaded to scroll to the next one. So you only have 2 seconds to capture their attention.
As far as like the hooks, do you think this is, I think you've told me kind of a breakdown and mix it between like music, text, visuals, like where do you kind of rank those in terms of getting somebody really engaged in that first couple seconds, or do they all equally kind of come into play?
I think it's the it can be a confusing image. So maybe something looks broken or something fell like that. Those are kind of easy if you can capture something like that. But for me, it's asking a question, making a statement that sparks some sort of emotional interest or teasing a result. You're not going to believe what this looks like at the end of this video. Or do you want to know what's inside this transmission of a machine? And then people will hang in for the end.
As far as your content output, do you have any goals for yourself as far as, you know, how often you want to put content out, your goals of performance? How do you kind of go about that? And sure, just for anyone else who's in, you know, who's trying to kind of mimic a style or a schedule.
I think once a day minimum. I've been, you know, told that up to four times a day is better, and I don't necessarily know that it is. I see a lot of big creators that do once a day maximum, you know, maybe twice a day. And I tend not to do much on the weekends because I find the engagement lower. But I can also show you a video that breaks every rule I'll tell you on this. So anything I tell you is sort of directionally, generally, the components I see in general to my best videos. But yes, I can walk out on a Saturday afternoon and I have a video that I think it's at 2.3 million views, and I filmed a washing machine really quickly, didn't take a lot of time, posted it from the parking lot, and by the time I got home, I knew it was a viral video.
Yeah, it's nice to know that you have some, you know, success to fall back on. You're kind of figuring out what could hit, what could not. I know it's always up in the air, and something we think is going to do really well maybe doesn't, and something we spend less time on, you know, can actually be one of your biggest videos.
Yep. It's like surfing or hitting golf balls. You know, you're going to get a hold of the odd one, but you're going to take a lot of swings to refine your approach. So
what type of videos do you enjoy watching? What types of the videos do inspire you and give you ideas to make your own content?
I'm following a lot of, it's all about authenticity for me. And like, maybe that's what people like in me. And that's what I like on TikTok. So my number one account that I cannot get enough of, I wish he posted four times a day right now, is a guy called Sean Gates, who's building his own little community in the desert. And the way he shoots it, the way he puts his content together, he's always moving, he's always doing a job, but he perfectly stitches the conversation through. It's just, I think it's a perfection of content, composition, and just style. I just think it's very authentic, but I love watching this live watch trading. I like watching, there's a guy that works on hydraulic cylinders called Shane Lapidel, and he just sort of puts a mic on and then edits his day when he's done. It's fascinating to watch. So I think authenticity and real situations are what I look for.
I like to go back to, I've seen a couple of videos of, you know, just a filthy pool and someone methodically kind of bringing it back to life. And it makes you feel good. It's like, do I have a pool? No. But did I enjoy that? Yes. Shifting gears a little bit to music, I know you've told me you kind of have a strategy for figuring out what music you think is going to fit in your videos. You mind sharing that?
Yep. I find it's much more about the rhythm. If I'm filming a slower video, you know, I pick a slower music. If it's really upbeat and I want to be excited, and it is just trial and error. I have probably like 100 or so videos saved in my favorites. And then I have probably 20 favorites that I use. And if it's inquisitive, I use something a little more inquisitive. And sometimes I just think, what kind of video is this? And I'll type that word into the search. And then I'll get a bunch of videos that are tagged with that word. So if I want something sad, if I want something upbeat or exciting, it's very easy to search the catalog. And it's really just trial and error until I find something I like. And it's just important too to make sure your audio levels are mixed accordingly so you don't overpower your voice with your audio.
A video with the perfect song or a less than perfect song, I mean, the results can be
even at 10%. When you drag, even if it's just subtly in the background where you barely notice it, it helps that video move a little bit quicker and helps viewer retention. It can sound very dry without it. When you add video audio to a video and then you listen to it without it, it feels like it's missing something.
Corey, I know you met with Sho at a convention. I believe it was in Washington, D.C. Is that correct?
Vancouver.
It was in Vancouver. Yep. Okay, got it. And why don't you tell us a little bit about that? Because I think that's kind of a great opportunity for you to come in. You gave your expertise, and I'm sure you heard a lot from some other business owners as well.
It's just fantastic. When I get to hang out, go to a TikTok event to hang out with fellow content creators, because it's definitely a interesting mix of people. We get each other. We can put our cameras in each other's faces, and we face the same struggles. I was so flattered to be invited. It all happened very quickly. And it was just fantastic. It was a top-notch event, and I learned, you know, you can be the leader of a big multinational company, but you can still be a great authentic guy that you can have a conversation with.
I think we're going to shift it over to the live Q&A. Corey and I will kind of be just monitoring these questions coming through and trying to address what we can. The first one that came out to mind is, I've lost who mentioned the question, apologies, but they said, can you show your authentic self without getting on camera? I think that's something that's from Naturally Crowned.
Well,
so thanks.
Getting on camera is the hardest part. When I try and coach people and say, you got to start a TikTok channel, the very first thing most of them say to me is, oh, I can't be on camera. Oh, I can't do that. So there's two easy ways to start. And one is voiceovers. Get your voice on camera. And the other one is filters. If you want to put on a goofy filter or you want to put on a filter to alter your appearance and it makes you feel more comfortable, go for it. I also notice a lot of people will do the voice modification. So a lot of them don't feel comfortable with their voice, so they'll change it to a chipmunk voice. I see a lot of people narrating stories that way. And once you get comfortable and once you start hearing that positive feedback, it's gonna build your confidence and you're gonna be a lot closer to putting yourself on camera. And you don't have to get there eventually. I just found it was a much stronger connection to the audience.
Do you always have to show your face right away?
No, you don't. I think if you did, I won't mention there is a creator that does the exact same intro every single time. And I find myself, I don't know why, I need to see something different and there's no differentiation. So no, I would start your videos differently. And no, you don't have to have your face on in the first few seconds.
Yep. Definitely. Yeah. We can always ramp up to becoming more comfortable to doing more, or if you're comfortable in, you know, the capacity that you're already working in and it works for you, that's great as well too. We have a live specific question here. Corey, I know you go live from time to time. Any tips to boosting your live, to getting more users to come?
Have not cracked the recipe on that other than just trying new things. And I guess my most successful, I think the most I've had with my followers is probably 4 or 5, maybe 600 people. And it was when I was doing probably over 2 hour period. So it takes a while to get the audience built. If you're getting a lot of engagement and you're on live for a while, it's going to be really tough for the first half hour, maybe the first hour. But if people are tuning in, you're going to see more and more people join. And I think I was balancing nickels on a washing machine. And we had a lot of people watching us do that and a lot of engagement. So tips on lives, no. I'll tell you, to be honest, I do lives for me. I find them just a great cathartic way to connect with the audience and maybe even to vent a little bit. A few of you have probably seen my evening lives where I probably shouldn't even do them. But I just find it fascinating. And just like this here, getting these live questions, I really thrive for it. And it's just a great to have a dialogue with the viewers.
Yeah, and we're actually getting a lot of good support from the comments themselves, people offering suggestions, be on live for at least 90 minutes. I think we have good resources in here. I think that just kind of lends itself to kind of our community and that there are a lot of resources just within, you know, other business owners here, right? So we're kind of all running the same race. Another question we have here, Bad Juju asked, is unrelated content a good way to mix it up, or should we stay exactly on topic?
I think don't do what I do. I think I'm just too lucky, too fortunate. My Show Chew series, I think it did 10, 12 videos. I was so excited. I was so happy. I wanted to share it all. And they got some of the worst views ever. And I was talking with some people at TikTok and they're like, you know, maybe it's an algorithm thing. The algorithm likes consistency. The algorithm likes you in your niche. And when suddenly I'm hashtagging Vancouver, probably from different IP addresses, who knows what the changes are. The algorithm didn't know what to do with me. But when it was come to maple syrup time and I said, well, I'm about to spend 3 months making maple syrup. I wonder if people will like it, but it's an appliance channel. My wife said, don't dare put your maple syrup on there. Don't jeopardize your channel. Don't move out of your niche. And I didn't listen at all. And I posted a video and now I get millions and millions of views. Two of my top 5 videos are maple syrup producing content. That's when I realized it's not about a store. It's not about product that people are tuning in for me or largely for me, or I guess they just like maple syrup and appliances. But
I think that's fine. Like we talked about earlier, kind of in the deck, like, you know, try different things. You know, you maybe build traction getting away from what you're, you know, really focusing on. I think, you know, at the end of the day, like if you're still ending up in that spot you want to be in, like that's fine. Go run your own race, go your own route.
You're right. And that's, I used to tell people too, if you post a video you don't like and 500 people see it, okay, big deal. Take it down, move on, you know, don't, or even leave it up if you want, you know, and if people see it, but don't get discouraged. You can't break it. You know, you can always recover. You just have to make more content.
Got it. Okay, a couple things here. Bad Juju hit us with the beard oil. I shaved recently, not for me. Corey, that might have been for you, for your
100% untreated. There. Yeah, natural. Yeah.
Yeah, we'll get you some product, though. It is looking good. We have, I believe it's Scion. Sorry if I'm saying that wrong. He's asking, are questions better than a visual hook? So I know you mentioned you know, maybe putting an image that's interesting to look at. Would you recommend questions or maybe that visual hook we talked about?
I'd have to say they're equal. So today, I don't know, maybe people see in my video, I pushed a refrigerator off the loading dock. And if I had have opened my video with that and then jumped back a little bit, I'm sure that would have been a great hook. But no, I think the right hook, I don't think I could choose one over the other. If you have good visual, maybe I would use the visual first. If you have something that's really interesting, you know, and I'm just trying to think what that is, you know, something damaged or a car, you know, hit something. Something intriguing that people are like, oh my gosh, what's that? How's that going to turn out? And they want to see the end of it.
Got it. We have one from Ascension Custom Prints. Looking for ideas on how to showcase their product. Any just kind of overall general tips on how to showcase a product? I know you've done that quite a bit.
Well, I try to get it in on its own. You know, I try to make sure I'm focused on that. I do a lot of movement. Movement's very, very important. You don't want static shots. You know, your brain's going to be focused on maybe voiceover or lighting, but you want to scan down. You want something dynamic. And really, I'm a salesman, and what's the feature function benefits? What's the three or four key things about this that are different than someone else? And when I do it, it might look like I do it in one take, and I do a lot of my videos in one take. Don't be afraid to say it 10 times. Don't be afraid to be a little obsessive, you know, and change that one little word. My videos, you'll notice there's not a lot of space between my sentences. So I spend a lot of time trimming those little 0.3 and 0.7 seconds so that there's no pause at all for the viewer to want to leave the video.
I think you hit it on the head, you know, key points of the item, you know, let the item, you know, really showcase what it can do with the differences between some other products. I think you nailed it there.
And a good example, if you don't mind, is I can take a front off a washing machine and show what's inside it. I can put a grill together, but then there's other products like mattresses, you know, that you can't really communicate because everything's stitched up inside. So everything has to be explained. Or if you are, I see a lot of success with candy stores, you know, so you can't really explain how something tastes. So it just depends on the product you're selling.
We have a question here from, I think it's Bain Boutique. They're saying, what do you do when you're discouraged by a sudden drop in views? So let's say, you know, maybe things are going well and you see a dip. How do you kind of get through that? Do you change strategy? Do you stay the course? How do you handle that?
I used to get discouraged and now I just move on. And sometimes if I really believe in the video, I will repost it. And I would say maybe one out of five videos that you repost might do better than the first time. I don't think they really like duplicate video. So that is also why I don't like to edit in the TikTok app. I like to edit in something like CapCut or one of the other editors, because then you can go back in later, maybe tweak your video a bit if you didn't like something. If you film it right in TikTok, it's gone. You know, it's posted. You don't have that raw material to work with again.
You mentioned CapCut, so we'll go on there, though. Tell us, like, how did you kind of learn about it, and what do you like about it? Is it useful? Do you recommend it to everyone here as far as using CapCut instead of the traditional editor here?
Yeah, for the first 2 years, I was only in the TikTok editor, and when I went to, I think it was the Toronto Global Forum last year, I was with some creators, and they're like, you do it all in the app, and I thought, I never thought of doing anything else, and it really came down to cross-posting. Some advice I got was if you do cross post videos, other networks don't want a watermark on it. So then I started editing my videos in CapCut and then tweaking them. You know, I put filters on in TikTok. I put graphics on in the TikTok app, my titles and my main editing's done in CapCut.
Awesome. Good to know. Yeah. For anyone here, you know, it's another product that's under our umbrella. So definitely check it out. A lot of good templates to help you kind of streamline some of your content to make it a bit easier to post. I know a lot of us here are...
I don't mean noise reduction. You get more control over or titles. You have amazing animated titles. You have a myriad of fonts you can choose from and colors. You can really go an extra mile when you go into CapCut. And then you have this video that you can go back. Maybe you want to do a 2-minute cut and a 30-second cut, and you can use CapCut, duplicate the file. It saves a lot of time and makes it really easy to cross-post and repost. Sorry about to add that in there.
No, not at all. Not at all. I think they're here to see you. What's the best time of day to post and day of week?
That's changed for me. I tell you, I notice 10 o'clock, 10 a.m., 5 p.m., and 7 p.m. in general are really good times. I do find Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday stronger than the rest. And I do tend to think, you know, Friday evenings, people are, you know, maybe enjoying life. I do find in the summertime it's different. And I've looked at maps online, and I don't know if I trust any of them because everyone's got different data on the best time to post. I tend to think, when are people playing on their phones? Think about you. Someone goes to work. Oh, it's almost lunch hour at 11 a.m. Okay, they might be on TikTok or they're out for a cigarette break. And then the 5 o'clock, people get home from work. Okay, dinner's getting ready. I might play on my phone. And then 7 o'clock is when they're hitting the couch, not watching TV because they're playing on TikTok instead. So yeah, that would be my answer for that.
So Babel's asking, views versus likes. Sometimes I get a lot of views, but not a lot of likes. What? How do you kind of value these? And what are you kind of looking for your content and your profile?
Great question. So on TikTok, you see higher engagement. If I see less than 10% likes to views, I feel like it's a bit of a fail. I was really averaging between 10 and 15%. And when I went to the Vancouver, met some other creators, they said, yeah, TikTok generally should deliver 10 to 15% engagement versus maybe 3 to 5% on other platforms. And I've noticed that right away. My videos don't get the same number of comments. The TikTok audience is different, and I don't know why, and I don't know how, but they're far more eager to engage. And I saw a stat recently where 83% of people on TikTok have posted a video. Well, that means those people are much more engaged in that environment on that platform. So that's why they engage more with your videos.
Here's a good question that came in here from Adrienne of AB Fab Designs. She's saying, how do I get more comments on my videos?
Ask questions. A lot of my videos end with, and as always, tell me what you think. I want to hear from you. What do you guys think? Do something wrong, pronounce something wrong. There's a video I always watch, and he talks about, you know, Mario and Luigi, and he calls it Mario, or instead of Chipotle, he calls it Chipotle, and he gets all these comments telling him he's wrong. So, but my biggest way to do is to ask questions. That's my primary way to generate comments.
Now that you mentioned it, I have seen a lot of those videos where it seems like the creator or the business is making very simple mistake that they should have caught. Yep. You know, but I think what you're saying is sometimes that's kind of like that, any publicity is good publicity. It's kind of that little hook. Yep. Within itself, and getting a chance for them to interact. Yep. With you, Corey. I don't know if you wanted to kind of sum up anything on your side, or maybe talk about anything that you're working on, or just give any of your thoughts on the TikTok business
account
in general.
Life-changing for me personally. It's been totally changing for our business. I always joke around, I feel like the most famous appliance store on the planet. It's opened up all sorts of doors for me and met all sorts of people and incredible customers that are doing things that I've never seen customers. Like, for a guy that did marketing in the appliance business his whole life, this is just like being on a different planet. And you're all doing your business for a reason. And if you're not, if you don't think you're passionate about your business, then maybe question that, because if you're going in and doing it every day and making your living, I hope you have some passion in it. And then you should be able to communicate that to people. Just articulate what you're doing, even if you're doing it for yourself. Make videos that you don't post publicly and look at them until you feel more comfortable with what you post. And other than that, just keep trying. Don't give up. And thanks very much to everyone that joined the talk.
Definitely, definitely give Corey a follow. Check out his content. Comment on his videos. I'm sure he's always willing to give you advice through his videos. He does a great job of it. Like we said, we brought him on. He's a passionate guy. And I think hopefully people here, if they're as passionate as he is about what they're doing, they can let that show through their TikTok business account. So once again, Corey, thank you so much for taking the time. Really appreciate it. And we hope to talk to you again.
Thanks, everyone. And if you want to hit me up in the comments with more questions, I'll do my best to answer them. Thanks so much. I got my head out the sunroof. I'm blasting.